Code Explained says hi, and welcome to the next part, the second part of building our meditation app. So in the previous part, the first part, which you will find the link to it here or in the description, we have created our app using just HTML and CSS. So we have made our app responsive using CSS grid. And now in this part, the second part, we're going to implement JavaScript. So now I can change the background video, and I also can change the audio duration. I can also play the video and animate our SVG here. I can pause the video, and when I am not inactive, when I am not moving the cursor for a certain time, they will disappear, the buttons will disappear. Also on the mobile version, I can click on this button to open and close our menu here, so I can change the background video. So like always, before typing any code, I'm gonna go and explain the logic behind it using some animations and diagrams. And I'm gonna ask you to like the video and subscribe to my channel. That's how you're gonna encourage me to make more of these videos, and that's how you're gonna help beginners out there. So without further ado, let's go and start this. So the first thing we want to do is toggling our menu. So when I click back on this same button, I'm gonna close the menu. So to achieve this, all we're going to do is adding a class name to this div here, which is our menu. And when I click back on this one, we're just gonna go and remove that class name we've added in the first time. So let's go and talk about the logic behind this before typing our code. So let's say we have here a text, which is inside the div with the class name text. If I go and select that text using any method I want, querySelector for example, now this text is an object and it has a property called classList. So when I say text.classList, this will return an array of class names that were set using our class attribute. So in this case, this will return text. Now this class list here has a method called add. So if I say classList.add and then black background, and this black background here is just a name of a class which is inside a CSS file that its background color here property is set to black. So if I say add the black background class name to the class list of text, this will just go and add that class name to the class list of our div here, and this will make the background of this text black. So that's easy. Now I can also remove a class name using the method remove. So this will do the opposite of the add and remove the black background from there, and we don't have any more the black background. And now we have the last method, which is the toggle method, which is the one we're going to use. So the toggle method here will simply toggle our black background class name. So if the black background class name is there in our class list, it will remove it. If it's not there, it will add that black background. So in this case here, if I run this line of code, the black background isn't there, so it will add it to the class list of this div, and this will add our black background. And now if I run the same line of code again, this will go and remove black background class name from the class list of our div, and our black background will disappear. So that's how we're going to open and close our menu, by just toggling a class name. So let's go and see this in action. Now the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go to our folder JS, and I'm going to open toggle seasons menu.js. So this is where our code for opening and closing the menu will live. Now inside our HTML code, I'm going to go and link that JS file to our HTML file. And then here I'm just going to go and add a class name called open for our seasons menu dev, and I'm going to go and set the right property in our star.css for that class name. So just under seasons, I'm going to add open the class name, and all I'm going to do is just play with the left property. So I'm going to set it to 0. Now if I save, you can see that the menu is opened, and if I remove that class name, it's now closed. So I'm just going to go and toggle that class name. Now I'm going to go and add another class name called rotate to rotate that button, the arrow button. I'm going to rotate it by 180 degrees when the menu is opened, like so. So let's go and do this using JavaScript. So I'm going to go to my file, toggle season menu, and I'm going to need to select two elements, the button, the arrow button, and our menu. So I'm going to use here dot toggle menu class name to toggle the button, and to toggle the seasons menu, I'm going to use the class name seasons. And now let's go and add an event listener to our button, the arrow button. So all I'm going to do is use our toggle menu to toggle that class name open. So now if I click on this, you can see we open our menu, but we have no animation there. So I'm just going to go and use transitions. So I'm going to transition the left using easing out for a timing function. Now if I click on that, you can see the animation there. Now I'm going to go and do the same thing for our open menu button. So we need to rotate it. So I'm going to toggle rotate, the class name rotate, we have created it. So now you can see the button has been rotated when I opened the menu, but we need a transition there. But we already have the transition for the background. So I'm just going to use all to transition all. Now if I open that, you can see the transition is there. And now we're done with closing and opening our menu. So let's go and move on to other things. And now it's time to make our buttons fade away when the user is inactive for a certain amount of time, and bring them back when he moves the cursor. So let's first close our toggle seasons menu.js. We're done with that. And now I'm going to link a new JS file, which is the file where the code for hiding the buttons will live, which is under our JS folder. So it's here. Now I'm going to go to the index.html, and for our whole app, I'm going to add a class name called inactive. And then I'm going to go to the style.css, and just under my app here, class name, I'm going to add the inactive, and all I'm going to set as a property is the opacity, and I'm going to set it to 0. And that's how I will hide my buttons. But I'm going to add some transition there to make the fade away and fade in effect. All right, now I'm going to go in my JS file, and I'm going to select our app using querySelector. And then instead of adding our inactive here, I'm going to add it using JavaScript. So I'm going to use the class list and then the add method and add my inactive class name. If I save, you can see that the buttons are hidden now. But we won't do this like this. We need first to know the last time the mouse has been moved. So I'm going to use the date object to set the time when the mouse has been moved for the last time. And then I'm going to go and listen for the mouse movement. So whenever the user moves the mouse, I'm going to go and bring back those buttons. So I'm going to go and remove the inactive class name from the app. So I'm going to show the app by getting to the class list of our app and remove the inactive class name. All right. Now, in the other hand, we need to deactivate our app when the user was inactive for a certain time. So I'm going to create a function to do that, which is called deactivateApp, And inside this function, we need first to check if the user was inactive for a certain amount of time. So the amount of time to consider the user is going to be a constant. So I'm going to go and create the constant, and you can choose the time you want to consider the user inactive. For me, I'm going to go for 3 seconds. So the constant is going to be called inactive time, and I'm going to set it to 3000 milliseconds, so which is 3 seconds. So here, I'm going to go and create a variable called now, which is the now time, and then I'm going to go and see the difference between the now time and the last time the mouse has been moved, and I'm going to call it delta time, and that's the difference of time between the last time the mouse has been moved and now. If that's bigger than inactive time, this means that the user was inactive for more than 3 seconds. And in that case, I need to hide the app. So I'm just going to go and add the class name inactive to the class list of our app. It's simple. And now I need to check if that's true. So I need to run our deactivate app like every millisecond. So I'm going to use a request animation frame to create a loop, and I need to call the function now just one time. So I'm creating a loop here using request animation frame. Now you can see that the app, that the buttons are gone, but when I move the cursor, you can't see them again. So here, whenever I move the mouse, I need to reset the last time the mouse has moved. So I'm just going to set it back to the new now time. So now if I was inactive for more than 3 seconds, they fade away, and now when I move the cursor, they come back. But again, if I don't move the cursor doesn't fade away. So we need to make the cursor fade away also beside the buttons. So I need here to hide the cursor also when the user was inactive. I'm just going to say document.body.style and then the cursor, and I'm going to set its property to none. So this is just CSS to hide the button. And here, when the user moves the mouse, we need to show back that cursor by setting to auto. And now if I save, if I was inactive for 3 seconds, the cursor must fade away, but you can see that it's not, because I'm using a screen recorder that records like the cursor in a certain way that's not like it appears like it's not fading away, but it does. And here I'm gonna go and comment this out, the hide button.js script, because I don't want my buttons to like fade out each 3 seconds when I am developing my app. So now let's go and move to the next part. Now it's time to control our audio using these two buttons here, play and pause. So I'm gonna go and link our file, the last file, which is the app.js file. And here I'm gonna go and close these two files and open our app.js. The first thing I'm gonna do is select our app and pause buttons using querySelector. So the class names are play.play, and I'm just gonna go and copy this whole thing to use it for our pause button. And then all I'm gonna do is I'm gonna add an event listener, a click event for the play button and the pause button. So here I'm gonna use a click event, and there it must be a semicolon. Then I'm gonna run an anonymous function. But first we need also to select our audio element to control it using JavaScript. So I'm gonna select the audio using the querySelector method. So this is our audio, it's inside the dev with the class name audio. So I'm just gonna say here audio, and then the audio, the HTML5 audio. Now what I'm gonna do is use the play method to play the audio, and then use the pause method to pause the audio. So if I click now, you can hear the audio is playing. And then if I click on pause, this will pause the audio. But I have here a little issue, and it is, the issue is, I can't click on the buttons in this area. So I'm gonna go and open my inspector here, and you can see that my SVGs here like cover these areas here from the buttons. So that's a CSS issue. So we need to go back to our style.css file and look for the style for the SVGs. And all I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go and set the Z index of the SVGs to -1, and this will put them in the background and the buttons will be in the foreground. Now you can see that I can click on my buttons in any area I want. And that's it for this part. Let's go to the next one. And now it's time to change the background video. So when I click on one of these buttons, this will change the video in the background. So let's see how can we achieve that. So we're going to achieve that using what we call the HTML5 custom attributes. So we have our buttons here to change the background video, and these are the HTML codes for each button. So just a dev with the class name season for all of them, and inside it's an image. All right. Now in the other hand, the source of the video we're gonna play in the background, it's like this. So we have a folder called assets, then inside it's another folder called video, and then we have our videos. So when I click, for example, on this button here, I need to set the video source to this source here, Spring. So how do I know the source of the video when I click on each of these buttons? So I'm gonna use the HTML5 custom attributes. So in this step here, I'm gonna add an attribute called video source. So this is a custom attribute, I can call it whatever I want, and I'm gonna set it equal to the path or the source of my video. So assets, then video, then Spring. The same thing for all of these buttons or all of these devs. Now when I click on one of these here, one of these buttons, I'm gonna go and look into the video source attribute, get the video source and set it to my video source. And that's it. Now let's go and implement this. So let's go to our app.js, and here I'm gonna go and select all of those buttons, the seasons or the season buttons. So I'm gonna use querySelector all. So I'm gonna select them all because they all have the same class name, which is season. So that season. So here you can see that they have all the same class name, season. And then I'm gonna go and also select our video. So that's how we can change its source using JavaScript. So I'm gonna select it also using query selector, and let's go to our HTML. So the video here is inside the dev with the class name video. So I'm gonna say that video, then video. So now that I selected my video, I'm gonna go and add an event listener to all of my seasons buttons. So I'm gonna use a for each to loop over the seasons buttons, and then for each season, I'm gonna add an event listener. And onClick, I'm gonna run an anonymous function, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna change the video search, the video we have selected in the line 16. So video.search, then I'm gonna use the season, which is our dev, and then we're gonna get an attribute. So let's go to our index.html here. So for each one of these buttons, I'm gonna add an attribute, a custom attribute called video search. and my videos are under the assets folder, then video. You can see it from here. So assets, then video, and these are my videos. So I'm gonna go here and say winter.mp4, and then it's gonna be spring, then summer, and then autumn. And now let's go and get that attribute using JavaScript and set to our video search, and that's it. And now if I go and click on the buttons, this will change the background video. And that's it for changing the background video. Let's go now to the next step. And now it's time to do the same thing with these buttons here. So when I click on one of these buttons, we're gonna change the audio duration here. So it's basically the same thing. We're gonna play with the attributes and get them using JavaScript and then change the audio duration here. So let's go and see how to do that. So I'm gonna go here and add some comments, some stupid comments. So here it's gonna be pause audio, then here it's gonna be like play audio. So, and now we need to select our durations or the buttons there. So I'm gonna use again the query selector all, because all of those buttons are devs with the class name duration. So here you can see it, I'll have the same class name duration. And then I'm gonna go and create a default audio duration. So when the app is loaded for the first time, we're gonna play the audio for 2 minutes. So that's the default duration. So 120 seconds, which is 2 minutes. So the audio duration now can be changed from 2 minutes when the user clicks on one of those buttons. So I'm gonna use a for each to loop over all those buttons and add an event listener, a click event, to each button. So when I click on one of those buttons, I'm gonna need to change the audio duration to this audio duration here, to the duration dot get attribute. So we're going to create an attribute called audio duration, and we need to create that attribute. So we're gonna go to our index.html, and here I'm gonna go and paste in audio duration attribute, and here it's gonna be 2 minutes, which is 120 seconds, 300 seconds, and 600 seconds, and 1200 seconds. And now before I move on, I'm gonna need to create a new button for 10 seconds. So just for like development purpose. So I'm gonna go here and console log the audio duration. So whenever I click on one of the buttons, I'm gonna console log the audio duration. So if I go to the console and then zoom in or make that bigger. So if I click on 10, you can see 10 seconds, 120, 300, 600, and 1200 seconds, and that's it. Now let's go and move on to the next step. Now it's time to create this animation, the SVG line animation. So if I hit play, you can see this animation here of our SVG. So that's all we need to accomplish in the next step. So first let's go and see the logic behind SVG line animation. So we have here our play and pause button, and inside here, beside the this time here, we have two SVGs. So if you have seen the first part, you know what I'm talking about. So we have two rectangles, one on top of the other. So we have a rectangle, but it's not filled, so it's transparent here. So we can't see the rectangle, but we can see the stroke. So because we have a stroke here, it's a red stroke, and its width, it's 10 pixels. So we can just see the stroke of our rectangle. And the second rectangle is on top of the first one, of the red one, except it's a white stroke. So they have all the same properties, except the stroke color, it's what is changed. So the stroke here is red and the stroke here is a white stroke. So you can only see the white stroke. And then when you click on the play button, then you see the animation happens, and that's when we see the red stroke is growing up. So actually the rectangle or the red stroke isn't moving at all. What's moving is actually the white stroke. So we're moving the white stroke from here, and that makes it like the red stroke is getting bigger as we play the audio. So how can we achieve that? First, I need to select the second rectangle, the white rectangle. I'm not gonna select the red rectangle because we're not gonna do nothing with it. So I'm gonna use this query selector, and I'm gonna select it using the class name here, rect, which you can see here, and I'm gonna set that to a constant called path. Now this path here is just our stroke here, the white stroke. Now let's simplify this by using just lines. So let's say this is our red stroke, and then on top of it we have our white stroke. Now if I go and use the start property and then the stroke-array property and set it to 50 pixels, this is what's gonna happen. So we have our red stroke, and then our white stroke now will be dashed, and every dash will be of a 50 pixels length. So we're gonna have the first dash, its length is gonna be 50 pixels, then a space of 50 pixels, then another dash, then a space, another dash, then a space, another dash, and then a space. So each dash here, its length is 50 pixels. Now if I set it to 100 pixels, you know what's gonna happen. We're gonna have dashes of 100 pixels and spaces of 100 pixels also. And then if I set the stroke dash array to 400, for example, this will make it like a dash of a 400 pixels, and it's gonna be like we have just one dash there. And now we have achieved the same thing we have before. So you can ask, why do we need to use stroke-array as we have already what we have here, what we have achieved. So why we need to use stroke-array? Because if I use stroke-array, now I can use the dashes. I can't move here the stroke, but instead I can move the dash. So to move the dash, I'm going to use another property, which is called stroke-offset. So if I set the offset of the dash to 50 pixels, this will move our dash here by 50 pixels. If I set it to 100, 150, 100, 200, and here you can see that as the dash offset is growing up, this here is moving to the right. So if I do this faster, okay, one more time, you can see that we have this animation here. It's like this line is moving to the right. So that's great. That's how we're gonna move our stroke here, or actually the dash, using the stroke dash offset. Now the only problem here is that here the stroke dash array is set to 400, which like covers the whole red stroke. So we need to cover the whole red stroke. None of the red stroke must be shown to the user, which is the case here. We need the white stroke to fully cover the red stroke. But if we set this stroke dash array, for example, to 400, it may cover the red stroke in a mobile version of our app, but in a desktop version, this will get bigger and it's not going to cover the red stroke. So in that case, we need to use another property called getTotalLength. This will get the length of the whole stroke, and that's what we're gonna set to be our stroke dash array. So if the length of this is 500 pixels, then the dash array, the stroke dash array, will be also 500 pixels, and that's the way we're gonna 100% sure that we're gonna cover the red stroke. Now let's go and see this in action. So let's go now and select our stroke, our rectangle, and the remaining time. So time inside that stroke. So I'm gonna use query selector to select both the rect, the path, and our remaining time element. So the class name here is rect. So that means I'm gonna use query selector. And then for the remaining time element, I'm gonna use the class name. So the class name is audio remaining time. And that's it. Now, the first thing is I'm gonna go and get the total length of our path, which is the same as like seeing the perimeter of our rectangle. So the path length here is gonna be our path dot total or get total length. And you know why I need this. And now I'm gonna go and set the stroke dash array to path length. So the dash will cover the stroke or the red stroke, fully cover the red stroke. All right, now if I set path length just to 5, it's not gonna cover it. So we have dashes of 5 pixels, dashes of 60 pixels, dashes of 80 pixels, dashes of 500 pixels, and dashes of 300 pixels. So it must be exactly the path length. That way it will cover the red stroke totally. And now we're just gonna play with the path that style that stroke dash offset. That's how we're gonna move the white stroke. So 20 by 40 by 50, and you can see that it's going anti-clockwise. If I use a minus, it's now going clockwise. So that's how we're gonna move our white stroke. And it's look like the red stroke actually grew in, but it's not. So I'm gonna use update function to update our stroke dash offset based on the portion played from the audio. So if I played, for example, 50% of the audio, then I want to move my stroke dash offset by 50% of the path length. Okay, so the portion played is the audio that current time divided by the whole length of our audio, which is audio duration. And now for the stroke dash offset, it's going to be proportional to the portion played. So path that style that stroke dash offset will be equal to portion played times the path length. I hope you understand this. Okay, now I'm gonna use I'm gonna call update once, and then I'm gonna use request animation frame to create a loop, because we need to update the stroke dash offset each millisecond. So if I click on play, now you can see that our dash, the white stroke, is moving, but we need to move it clockwise. So I'm gonna add a minus here, so I'm gonna click on that again. Now it's moving the other way, and that's great. Now if I choose 10 seconds, you can see that very well. And when it reaches the end, it starts over. So we need to stop the audio from playing when we reach the audio duration. So I'm gonna check if the audio that current time is greater than the audio duration. So we need to like pause the audio. And then to actually stop the audio, I'm gonna go and set the audio current time back to 0 seconds. So the beginning of the audio. So we pause the audio and then stop the audio by setting the current time to 0. And now if I check that again, and good. So when it reaches the end, it stops. But now I'm gonna go and do something. I'm gonna go and console log something to the console update. For example, if I open the console, you can see that our update is still running, although the audio has been paused, which is not good. So what I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna use an if statement. I'm gonna say if audio.paused not paused. That's when I want to request animation frame update. So now if I go and open my console and then refresh and click on play, the audio is playing, but you can see the update function. We can see the stroke moving, which means that we need to go and fix this. So we need to go to the top. When I click on the play button, when I click on the play, I need to play the audio and also initiate the loop by calling the update function. So now if I go and open my console play, now you can see that stroke moving and also our update function there is being called each time. So when that ends, when the audio reaches the end, you can see that the update has been stopped. And that's it for this step. Let's now move on to the next one. And now we have reached the last step, and in this step we're going to handle this countdown timer or clock or whatever. So when I click on the play button, you can see this counting down. So let's go and see the logic behind this. So to achieve such thing, we need to talk about the remainder operator in JavaScript. So when we have for example modulo 2, this will return 0 because 4 divided by 2, it's gonna be 2, and there is nothing left from the division. So but instead, if I say 10 divided by 3, in that case is gonna be 3 as a whole number, and 3 times 3 it's 9. So 10 minus 9 is 1. So what's left from the division is 1. So 10 modulo 3, it's gonna be 1. So the remainder operator returns the remainder leftover of a division. Let's say we have here an audio duration of 2 minutes. When I click on play for 7 minutes, this is how it's gonna look like. So 1 minute and 53 seconds is the remaining time, means we have like played 7 seconds of our audio. Alright, now how can we figure it now? This is the question. How can we figure out this? Alright, we have selected our audio using querySelector. Now if I use the current time property, this will return 7. So 7 seconds is what we've played from our audio. And then the audio duration is 120, which is 2 minutes. Alright, so this is what we have as like data. So to know the remaining time here, I just need to like subtract 7 from 120. So 120 minus 7 is the remaining time. So 120 is the audio duration minus the audio.currentTime will be just the remaining time in seconds. And the result of this in this example is going to be 113. So now it's just a matter of how we're going to get the seconds and the minutes of these 113 seconds. To get the minutes, it's going to be easy. We're just going to go and divide 113 by 60. This will return a decimal number, 1.888333. So 1 here means 1 minute, right? So 1 113 seconds has 1 whole minute inside of it. So I'm going to use math.floor here to get this integer. I don't want this. So math.floor will return the number of minutes in 113 seconds. And then to get the seconds or the remainder of this division here, I'm just going to use the modulo or the remainder operator. So I'm going to say 113 modulo 60, and this will return 53, which is exactly what we have here. So now I just need to take the minutes and the seconds and format them like this. And that's it. Now let's go and see this in action. So now we need to like calculate the remaining time or the remaining minutes and seconds. For that, I'm going to go and create a function called render remaining time. So this function here would calculate the remaining time in minutes and seconds and also render it to the user interface. And from time in second, we're going to get our minutes, and I'm going to use math.floor here to get an integer, because it could be a decimal, a float number. And then I'm going to get the seconds using the remainder operator, just like we have seen before. And now I'm going to go and render this using inner HTML property to the user interface. So I'm just going to put the minutes, then a colon, and then the seconds. And then that's it. I'm going to go now inside our update function. And then here, I first need to calculate the remaining time in seconds. So let remaining time in second is going to be equal to the audio duration minus the audio that current time. And I'm going to use now my function render remaining time, and it's going to take in the remaining time in seconds. I'm going to hit save, and now you can see we have this not good looking timer. So what I'm going to do here, I'm going to go to the bottom. So if I play that, you can still see that we have that problem. So I'm going to go here and check if the minute is less than 10, which means the minute are a single digit. I'm going to go and return the minute with a zero just before that single digit. The same thing for the seconds. So here, what this does, what these two lines of code does, if the minute or the seconds is a single digit, example 9, 8, 7, so less than 10, we add a zero just before that single digit. Alright, so now 9 will be 09, 8 will be 08, etc. So if I save now, you can see that now our timer is looking just like we want it to look. And now we have the 0 before 1, because 1 is 1 digit. Right, is a single digit. Now what I want you to see here is when I click on these buttons, you can see that the remaining time is changing. That's good. But if it's not playing, when I click on these buttons, nothing happens. Although the audio duration in the background, it's changing. You can see that when I click on play, it has been changed. You can see it now. So to fix this, what I want to do is I'm going to go and call the update function whenever I click on a button, on a duration button. And that's how I'm going to update the remaining time. So I'm going to go now and check if it works. And yes, so whenever now I click on a button, we call the update and we update the whole thing. And that's good. So I think that's it for our tutorial. This is the end. I'm just going to go and check one more time our meditation app. And yes, I still need to like uncomment the script here to hide the buttons when the user is not inactive. And now I'm just gonna go and change the background and go full screen and let's meditate. Okay, this is it, guys. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe and like the video. Thank you. See you in the next tutorial.